Hello, I am Francesca Knittel-Bowyer, and my mother, I'd like to say is, was, because now God has her in his arms. She was a wonderful mother, but always the consummate actress. I think she acted her way through motherhood. Somebody once said to me, Francesca, you weren't born like most. You were hatched out of a Fabergé egg. And I laughed, I think more because it would be so true of my mother. I have to say about her, she had a flair and a taste that most people don't even have in their little finger. She was quite an extraordinary woman. She knew how to dress, she knew how to act, and she was an extraordinarily intelligent woman who was able to grasp the essence of life and all that was around her always, which I think helped to make her such an amazing actress because she took from life and it came from within her and she gave out so readily. She had so many personas that she wanted to give out and share with the rest of the world. She had so much love that she needed to share it with an audience, with a world, not just with a family. My mother actually started by wanting to be a ballerina, but for some reason, that did not pan out. She left home when she was 16 and hid in the attic of a very well-to-do aunt in Dusseldorf. Her father was furious that she wanted to become an actress because becoming an actress in those days was like walking the streets and becoming a whore. But she was determined this is what she wanted to do. Her first tryout that she heard about tryouts for the theater, and she went to a tryout, learnt a wonderful one-woman part. So my mother went to the theater to audition, and in those days you had to bring all your own props onto the stage. She needed a sofa where she can lie down and pretend she was dying, do this whole dying part. She lugged the sofa onto the stage, which was huge and very heavy, lay down on it with a sense of great drama and forgot every line she was supposed to deliver. So that was it. They sent her back home and said for her to come back when she remembered her lines, which she did. Long story short, she passed the audition and she worked with a small repertory theater for a small while in Dusseldorf and then was discovered by Reinhardt and his theater group with which she worked for quite a few years, leading her to the stage in Austria. Lo and behold, there was a talent scout who came to Austria, to Vienna, where she was living at the time, who was looking for a famous actress that Louis B. Mayer had sent him over to get back to America. And he discovered my mother instead of this other actress and contacted Louis B. Mayer and said, I have found the greatest actress in the world. They brought my mother over. When she was asked to go over, she said, I'll go on one condition, that I can bring my little Scotty with me. She had a little Westie, Johnny, who she absolutely adored. And she said, I will only go to Hollywood, as she used to call it, if I'm allowed to bring my little dog Johnny. So they allowed her to go. They found her this beautiful home in Malibu, where she stayed, and she would walk the beaches and walk the beaches and walk the beaches. Nobody ever called her. And until a woman came running down the beach who was working with MGM and said, they are looking for an actress in Escapade, this wonderful movie called Escapade. You should go and present yourself. And this is how she started in Hollywood. Louis B. Mayer, when he first saw my mother, said, you brought me a vampire. I wanted a beautiful actress. Well, she was very, very beautiful. But to him, it was, he wanted another Garbo. My mother was chosen to play the part of Flo Ziegfeld's wife. And when she was chosen, she was did not have top billing. So William Powell went to Louis B. Mayer and said, LB, if you don't star this woman, not woman, girl, if you don't star this girl, you're going to make me look like a fool. And my mother said that William Powell was responsible for making her a star, because that was her real start. Although she did play, she did have a big part in Escapade, which people raved about and said, where did this beauty come from? Where did this great actress come from? However, her real start was through William Powell, getting top billing with him and Myrna Loy. My mother was not expecting to get an Oscar. During the Oscar nominations, she heard her name was there, but she thought, of all the extraordinary actresses, I'll never get this award. And so she stayed home and obviously was listening to the radio, the awards as they started to give them out. And she got a call at home saying, you better come because you're going to win an Oscar for The Great Ziegfeld. And she was stunned. So I have to say, she threw this very coat over her pajamas and went to receive the Oscar. It was her first Oscar. And as I look at this coat, I'm so excited. I have not seen this coat in 30 years. And all of a sudden, I get a call saying that the Hollywood Museum now had it. And I was so excited, and this is the first time I'm seeing this coat. And my mother gave it to me, and she always asked me, she always said, Francesca, do you ever wear that coat? And for some reason, because it was big in the shoulders and tiny in the waist, I never really did, and I would always make excuses about it and say, well, I wear it sometimes and this and that and the other, but I don't have a lot of occasion to wear it. And my husband ended up giving it to a museum. And now it's here, and I'm so happy it's here. It's in such wonderful hands, and it's closer to me now. So I've got to say, she was given the coat by her first husband, Clifford Odets, who gave it to her. Yeah, the shawl, my mother had her own style. And I do remember people would stop my mother in the street always, some of them recognizing her and others not recognizing her, and say, you are the most elegant woman I have ever met and or I have ever seen. that was the way she was all her life till her dying day. My mother, if she took on a character, she studied that character. She went to Chinatown because she wanted to know exactly how a Chinese woman, a humble Chinese woman, behaved. She went to Chinatown and she saw this one woman who understood who my mother was, doing a tour of Chinatown. And my mother saw in this woman, this young woman, Olan. She, my mother by accident dropped her bag. And this woman immediately went down to pick it up. And my mother went down to pick it up. And they bumped heads. And this woman was just terrified that she might have hurt my mother or touched her. And that's how my mother found the character of Olan when she saw this woman. I want to introduce a young man who I think is going to be one of the biggest up and coming Hollywood journalists. He interviewed me not long ago. He knew more about my mother, I wager, than even I did. But he has stories about my mother that are extraordinary. I'd like to introduce Jack Priest. Jack, tell me a story about my mother that stands out to you.
Well, I think since we're speaking about the good earth, when your mother was cast as Olan, I think it's important to share that when she found she was cast, she went to Irving Thalberg's office and she said, "Look, I think there's another actress who could do this role better than I could." And I'm assuming that was Anna May Wong, who was a Chinese actress at the time, but racism was still a big thing back in the day. And Irving Thalberg completely disregarded what she had to say and pushed her by the neck out of the office and just escorted her out.
Yes.
But I think the great thing about that story is she tried to do the right thing, because she knew at that time as well that it wasn't right, you know?
Not only that, the makeup artists who worked with my mother wanted to do a whole Chinese mask for her. And my mother said, "I refuse to wear a mask. If you want to make up my eyes a little bit, make up my lips, but leave me exactly the way I am. Because Olan is coming from inside me. I don't have to be made to look like a Chinese woman." And she portrayed Olan in the most extraordinary way. And when you watch the movie, you really think that you're seeing a Chinese woman. And that was her ability to become another personality.
So Francesca, as many people know, your mother was the first person ever in Oscar history to win back-to-back Academy Awards. The first one was for the Great Ziegfeld, but the second one for The Good Earth, that one's a funny story with what ended up happening to it. Would you mind sharing a bit about that?
I will tell that story. My mother claims, and I actually think I saw her do it, used one Oscar as a doorstop to our garden in Connecticut. It weathered, and as my mother said, it started to lean like the Leaning Tower of Pisa. Years later, my mother called the Academy and said, "I need another Oscar." And they, "Louise, what do you mean you need another Oscar?" She said, "Because I think that my one Oscar has battle fatigue." And she explained how this Oscar, which was used as a doorstep, starting to lean a little bit towards the right. And so, with big pomp and circumstance, she was invited back to the lot of Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer, and where she was presented with a third Oscar, or a second or third, but the replacement for the old Oscar. A few years later, when my father passed away, sadly, she was still living in Switzerland, and that house was far too big for her alone, and she was going to move back to London. And I went over there to help her with the movers, and I went down. They had a cellar, which is as big as most people's houses, but immaculate condition. And there stood this one leaning Oscar. And I said, "Mommy, what are you going to do with that Oscar now that you have the new one and the other one that's still straight standing?" She said, "Well, I'm taking it with me." And then I said, "Well, I would love to have it." And she said, "You can't have it. It's not allowed." I said, "But Mommy, I'm your family. I won't do anything with it." About a year later, after she'd sold everything in the house and the movers came to London, and I went to London to help her unpack all the packages. And she said, "You take care of the study or her office and all the memorabilia and put it in the right places, et cetera, et cetera." So I saw two boxes on the floor that were marked Oscars. And I took out the Oscars, and I couldn't find the one that I had wanted with the battle, so-called battle fatigue. So I went to my mother and I said, "There are only two Oscars there. Where's the other one?" She says, "Oh, darling," she said, "you know, the electrician," she was living in Lugano, "the electrician came over and I didn't have the cash to give him. So I gave that one to an electrician. It is some electrician in Lugano." And I said, "You did what?" "So there is an electrician in Lugano, in a little village, that has an Oscar. I don't know that he knows even what it is."
So, Francesca, as many people know, your mother's film career wasn't extremely long. When she felt she needed a vacation, and when she went to LBMAIR,
the spark started to fly.
Yes.
My mother walked into LB's office, and he said, "Come here, darling, come here, sit on my lap." She said, "Mr. Mayer, I don't sit on anybody's lap." And she took a seat directly opposite him at his desk. And she said, "Mr. Mayer, I need a vacation. I'm going away." He said, "You can't go away. You're under contract for three more films." She said, "LB, I need a vacation." He said, "Why do you need a vacation? You can't have a vacation. You're still under contract." She said, I need to find my soul." He said, "What do you need a soul for? You've got a director, don't you?" She said, "I need to find my soul. I need to go to the mountains. I need to get away from this environment." And he said, "You leave now and you will never work in this town again. We made you and we're gonna break you." And she looked in his eyes and she said, "Mr. Mayer, let me tell you something. God made me. And when you are dead, I will still be alive for many, many years." And with that, she walked out of his office and she took her vacation.
Your father, Robert Knittel, was a famous publisher, and, you know, obviously publishing and writing is in your blood. How did you come about to start writing your book, Seen from the Wings?
Well, my father his lineup of writers were amongst those like Solzhenitsyn, Herman Woke, Sidney Sheldon, James Aubrey. The list goes on and on and on. But he was very critical of a lot of writers. And there are some very big writers who wanted my father to publish their books, and he wouldn't touch them. And one day I went out to lunch with my father, and I had written a treatment for a television screenplay. And I'd given it to my father very timidly, because I was worried about him reading anything that I'd written. And as I say, we went to lunch and sat down, and he said, "I read what you wrote." He said, "You're a very talented writer, and this is something that you have got to keep up with. And I like what you did, and I have somebody you can give it to." Well, unfortunately, he passed away from cancer. He got very sick, and he couldn't move on further. But he was my inspiration for writing. I've written a great deal, reams of poetry. And I started writing this book because I believe that so often in life we are a product of those who raised us, our parents, our mothers, fathers, aunts, uncles, whoever raised us. And very often in life, we veer to those who were more dominant in our lives, and those who had a very important role in our life, but who kind of were secondary. My father was definitely not secondary. In fact, in retrospect, I think that he was an amazing influence in my life. But as a result, I ended up marrying the personality of my mother, who was very tough on me, but who I loved very, very much. And because I so believed in marriage, I wanted to keep this going, even though most people said, "Why didn't you leave this man?" But there was another man in my life who was like a buffer. He was a friend, a platonic friend, and he was a buffer to all the tremendous upset I went through in my marriage. And he was the personality of my father. So the bottom line was, I found both my parents all over again. And when I was young, I was fearless. And I knew I had to get away from this, the environment that I was being coaxed into, because I had to find myself. And this book is full of the adventures and the breakaways, finding the me who I really was. And here I am, a book later. It's had wonderful reviews, which I'm very proud to say. Seen from the wings, it has something that everybody can relate to. It's got a lot of the human factor in. It's got a lot of humor, a sense of positivity, which is so important in life. And it's how I crossed all the hills and valleys and ended up on a great peak.
So, Francesca, you shared a very interesting story about the baby in this photo.
This baby, he came to me about, 30 years ago. He was an elderly man. And I got he called me and said, "I was your mother's baby." And I said, "What is he talking about?" And he said, "I was her baby in the good earth. And I'm here in Beverly Hills." I was living in Beverly Hills at the time. And I was able to meet him. And he's a lovely, lovely man. I don't know if he's still alive, but very lovely man. So that was exciting.
What a story. And there's this amazing program from the premiere.
That is amazing, yes.
At Carthay Circle of the Good Earth.
That is amazing. This is just amazing. And this was the for the good earth. That is amazing.
So both of these films premiered at the Carthay Circle Theatre, which is no longer standing, but they did provide some great programs, both the Great Ziegfeld in 1936 and The Good Earth in 1937.
Amazing. And where is this now? I mean, where was it located?
In Miracle Mile. So it's sort of Carthay Park.
Yes, I know exactly. It's amazing, these programs, the way they were. They were so beautiful.
Love this beautiful
portrait.
I
love this picture. This is so beautiful. And you know, looks very much like my daughter.
Oh, really?
My youngest daughter, Nicole. Yes.
Is that a skull cap all the way back
yes,
then?
Yes, and you know, she wore them till the last. She never would go out without a skull cap, ever.
You still have some of her skull caps?
I have two.
Oh.
Yeah, I wish I had more.
And then there's this wonderful photograph by Clarence Sinclair Bull that your mother actually signed.
Yes, I see that. Can you see this?
Tehran,
with all best wishes, Luise Rainer. Beautiful picture, beautiful face. So beautiful. She was very beautiful.
Your mother's famous Oscars.
I see that. This is the new one that took over from the battle fatigued one. This was from Austria, an award. It was a porcelain award that is like the Oscars. And those were on her shelves in London, in her office.
And then this is a new addition to Angie and Chris's collection, this great photograph your mother's estate.
I love this. I know this picture. This is a beautiful picture. And it so has her character in there. I will come just as close as I want to come to you. That's what that says. Don't try coming any closer.
Picture says a thousand words.
It certainly does.
And then some wonderful sheet music from the Great Ziegfeld.
Oh, that's amazing.
Well, thank you once again, Francesca, for your visit. It's wonderful to have you here. We loved hearing all the stories of your mother, Luise Rainer.
My pleasure.
Yeah, and for everyone, all our guests, if you're in Los Angeles during March, come in and see what we've got on display here. It's Oscar season, and we're helping to celebrate. So once again, from Hollywood Heritage, we hope to see you soon. Visit us at Hollywood Heritage. We're open Friday through Sunday, 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. We'd love to see you come in.
It's a wonderful place.